from the University of Michigan, and she will tell us more about green functions.
So let me share the slides. All right. So thank you very much for inviting me. This is a real pleasure to be here, even though the format is virtual, but I guess, you know, we are going to stay for some time with this format. David told me I should give a decent introduction to Green's function, and I must say this is actually very, very difficult because this field is so huge. So I decided to tell you just a little bit about Green's function and then show some interesting examples that we can nowadays do with Green's function calculations for realistic materials, and hopefully that will motivate you enough to, you know, to maybe look up more about Green's functions. So I will tell you a little bit about embedding theories, but I will also tell you about different phases of strongly correlated solids and how they influence orbital characteristics. So as I told you, I will tell you about this Green's function theories. I will try to present a little bit about self-energy embedding theory. This is a theory which has as a major component self-energy, which is basically like a quantity that describes interaction between electrons. It's a Green's function theory that we develop in my group, and I will use this to treat some strongly correlated systems. So one of the biggest problems in, I would say, in this Green's function world is that there are these disjoint communities. There is community that deals with model Hamiltonians. There is community that deals with weakly correlated solids. And I would say nowadays, I think also in the quantum chemistry, there is a community that also deals with that description. So basically one of the goals is, you know, to get these methods to a regime where the calculation can be very accurate in the way that a quantum chemist would be satisfied with that accuracy, not just a person who treats model Hamiltonians. So there are many challenges if one wants to go to solids. So one has to have a good basis set. And we actually work with Gaussian basis sets for solids. So one wants to have some very good representation of the occupied orbital space, and obviously, you know, as few virtual orbitals as possible, but one has to have some. So basically we want to have some compact bases, and, you know, most of the bases are optimized actually in atomistic calculations. So one would want to have it material specific for solid. So if you are interested in, you know, in this, look up this paper. This actually nicely explains, you know, the idea of some of this type of research for solids. Then in the Green's function methods, we have this weakly correlated method, which describes the whole problem. Usually we want to have a finite temperature method if we want to analyze some kind of materials, because different phases, they arise due to temperature. And one of the biggest, you know, challenges is to make it cheap enough to actually make the periodic calculation possible. So one wants to have robust convergence and basically some robust treatment of the finite size effects. And finally, we have this embedding scheme, which allows us to, you know, to actually pick pieces of these calculations which are most expensive and, you know, where the strong correlation is most necessary. So one goal of such scheme is that it should be, you know, as well defined as possible, and the best would be if it was systematically improvable, because then one could, you know, systematically validate if such calculation is converged with respect to all correlation effects. So one would want, you know, to presumably choose as few strongly correlated orbitals as possible, because that's expensive. And one would want to return some experimentally relevant quantities. So usually these quantities for systems that I'm interested in, which are solid, are some kind of spectra. All right, so how this, you know, Green's function embedding scheme is working and what are our goals? So in a solid, right, you take some sort of, like this is a little bit extreme example, you know, Piotr was talking about the frontiers, right? So he was telling that strong correlation is the final frontier. So I guess that the solids are like infernal frontier maybe. So one would want to take, you know, this big solid, choose something what is the most relevant for description of the physics, right? So in here, like in this cuprate, for example, that would be most likely the planes of the d electrons of copper. And, you know, one would want to describe this part basically very accurately, while all the rest approximately. So what that means that, right, that one wants to have some sort of connection between the chosen fragment and the rest. So what we're doing is the quantum mechanics in quantum mechanics embedding, where basically this chosen fragment is an open system where the electrons can be exchanged between this chosen fragment and the rest of the solid that is described approximately, and the wave function of this chosen fragment can delocalize to the rest of solid. And I would say that this quantum mechanics in quantum mechanics embedding, you know, this undergoes intensive development, and different people will use different quantities. I use Green's function, but you're going to see people who can do this at the level of more wave function theory, like in DMET, or, you know, at the level of density functional theory, like, the, for example, the theory of Wesołowski. So many people are trying to do this, right, because this allows basically to reduce the size of treated problem. So in this Green's function language, the most important quantity that we can try to evaluate is called self-energy and how to think about it. Okay, so imagine that we have some sort of uncorrelated system. So in this uncorrelated system, the electrons are moving in the mean field. All right, so, and this system, we can say that it's described by zero order Green's function. So we'll call it G zero. And then there is some correlated system where the electrons are explicitly correlated, and this is described by the full Green's function. So the quantity that connects this to basically two entities is called self-energy, all right? And this self-energy is basically like a difference between the inverses of uncorrelated and correlated Green's function. So this quantity is describing all the correlation, many body effects present in the system of interest. If some Merlin gave us this quantity, we would know everything about the correlation structure of a given system. So as a theorist, our goal is basically to find a ways of, you know, of describing this self-energy, basically. And most likely this means approximate ways, because only for very few small systems one can find an exact way. So in this Green's function language, in very similar way actually to DFT, there is like a universal functional that describes, you know, how we deal with the objects like self-energy and Green's function. This functional is called Latinger word functional. If you are interested, actually, you know, it was derived 1 year before Hohenberg-Kohn functional. And you can think about it as some kind of temperature dependent version, actually, of Hohenberg-Kohn functional, with this difference that you have an exact prescription how to build it, all right? So in this functional, we basically take a subset of skeleton diagrams present in this many body Green's function expansion. And we can take it, you know, in a perturbative way. So we can take it at the level of various method. We can have a Latinger word functional at the level of GW, where basically the sum of bubbles are included. We can have it at the level of GF2, which is the Green's function second order, where you basically include the second order diagrams, so you have the second order exchange and so on. And then the self-energy is defined as the functional derivative of this Latinger word functional with respect to Green's function. So you can see that there are these definitive analogies, right, to DFT, in the same way as VXE is the functional derivative. So our functional basically depends on the Green's function and the Bayer interactions. So this is the way we define it. And right, and we try to find the approximations to this functional, or alternatively, you can find the approximations to the self-energy. So this is like in gist, you know, what we're trying to do in many of these Green's function methods. And basically, this functional is built in a perturbative way. So that's like a bad news, because we know, as Piotr actually showed, that many of these perturbative expansions, they converge pretty slowly. So what we're trying to do, we're trying somehow, you know, to, for realistic systems, to accelerate this convergence. So if you imagine that we have such spin crossover molecule. We could then partition it into some kind of subsystem. So we had a system and environment, and we could describe this environment at the lower functional level and the system at the higher functional level, where we would include, you know, many more diagrams into this functional description. So this can be physically motivated. It doesn't actually need to be. But nevertheless, we would set up this four Lattinger word functional as some kind of functional at the low level plus a functional description at the high level, for example, of the d orbitals minus some kind of double counting, so we don't count any diagrams twice. And since the self-energy is the functional derivative, right, it would basically follow this type of prescription. So we worked for a long time in this method, which is called self-energy embedding theory. So where basically we would say, you know, this physically motivated division is not necessary. What we can do is we can basically find the self-energies of strongly correlated orbitals, and you know, we can have total energy, self-energy of weakly correlated orbitals, and embed the strongly correlated orbitals as some kind of subgroups and construct this functional in this way. So this can be generalized. So this strongly correlated electrons, you know, they can be on different centers. They don't need to overlap. So you can have, for example, separate D centers, or you can really, you know, have them on a single D center, and then you can have overlapping fragments where you need to subtract the contributions you count twice due to these overlaps. So you have like something like a kind of many-body self-energy expansion, and this functional can be very nicely generalized. So our task, right, would be to find self-energies and this functional that correspond to this construction. And, you know, hopefully it will be cheap enough that we can do big problems. So what, like how, you know, how such calculation goes. So we have basically all the orbitals of the problem, like, you know, this would be all orbitals either of a solid or molecule. And because we don't, you know, we don't necessarily talk about the spatial separation, we can separate things in the energy scale, right? And we can treat the weakly correlated low-lying orbitals differently from the orbitals that are near the Homolumo gap or Fermi level. And then again, you know, the weakly correlated virtual orbitals. So we can use different methods, right, to describe this kind of strongly and weakly correlated orbitals. And we can do this in most likely systematic manner by, you know, changing the sizes of this group, or, for example, changing the order of perturbative description. And we would want to, you know, to maintain chemical accuracy. So this method is designed that way that, you know, hopefully you can get chemically relevant results. And we include temperature, right? We include the typical properties of Green's functions, usually to simulate the spectra for some kind of solid problem. So what, you know, what in practice that means, right? That when you have this weakly correlated orbitals, you usually are using some type of Hartree-Fock, GF2 or GW method to describe this weakly correlated orbitals. And you use some kind of, you know, either high-level coupled cluster, we work on such solvers, or some kind of truncated CI, right? Or full CI in order to describe this group of few strongly correlated orbitals. So what that means, right, is that in practice, you separate this kind of problem you wouldn't be able to treat as a whole, like, you know, the whole solid, for example, into a group of manageable calculations, all right? So what, right, you will do one huge calculation for the full solid, let's say at GW or GF2 level. So actually that's usually very expensive. Usually you would want some kind of decent computational power for that. And then you will have few calculations where you basically embed the strongly correlated orbitals into some kind of non-interacting buff. And these are, you know, molecular-like calculations for selected set of orbitals, which actually are, you know, fairly accessible, and they can be done pretty quickly. So and when you're collecting the self-energies, right, or the functional pieces from these different calculations and add it all together in order to get the final result. So how it goes, right? So you do this basically huge calculation on a giant solid. So usually you have some sort of, you know, momentum resolution and a decent K-grid. And that gives you the starting Green's function. Based on the starting Green's function and, you know, starting density matrix, you select some strongly correlated orbitals. And as I'm saying, this can be either, you know, physical, so you can select some d orbitals, you can say select the orbitals near the Fermi level, you could produce the density matrix within this unit cell and, you know, select them based on some partial occupations, so different schemes are possible. When you do this embedding calculation, right, for the selected strongly correlated orbitals, you set up this self-energy and you drive this to convergence. So this procedure is self-consistent because you want to get this Latinger word functional, which is, you know, the final product that we want to obtain usually to fulfill some sort of exact conditions. And because of that, we want to do it self-consistently. So one of the major pieces that we have to have, right, is this weakly correlated calculation for the whole solid. And I cannot stress actually how, you know, important that is, that this calculation is affordable and it's converged. So even though in principle, we, you know, in practice, actually not in principle, in practice, we treat this full strongly correlated solid. Many times, actually, the most challenging calculation is the good calculation for this week for the entire solid done at the weakly correlated level. So in our case, we do it based on GW in Gaussian orbital basis. So here again, it's very important that the basis is good enough. We use density fitted Coulomb integrals from pi SCF. And then, you know, the resulting cost of such calculation is basically the number of K points squared, the number of orbitals in the unit cell squared. We have the size of the auxiliary basis squared due to the density fitting and the number of tau points, because we do this calculation on an imaginary time grid, or, you know, a grid that has discretization due to temperature. So that is also a sizable factor. And that's why, this is why this calculation, you know, is more expensive than your traditional GW calculation you do, which is on real axis. So this efficient finite temperature grid, if you want to resolve this finite temperature effect, it's actually a, you know, decent field of study. We have contributed ourselves actually quite a bit to studying these different grids. And I would say, you know, since the time I started working in that field in 2012 to right now, you can see that there were quite some grid incarnation, but, you know, really, this intermediate representation grid or Legendre polynomial grid was good enough that allowed us to do these calculations for decently sized solids. And you can see that, you know, with this grid, like, you basically have the convergence of the total energy, which is very good. You don't, you know, lose any digits or anything like that. So that, I would say, in this field was, even though extremely technical, actually, incredible progress, and very important to make it all, you know, converge, reproducible, and well behaved. So I very much encourage you to take a look at these papers. All right, so then if one has that, you know, one can really evaluate efficiently many of the thermodynamic quantities for solids. And this is just, you know, to show you that indeed this is possible. This is entropy evaluated as a function of temperature in very simple solid lithium hydride, but, you know, this is just to demonstrate that's possible. I'm going to show more. Then, right, internal energy and, for example, specific heat at constant volume. All right, so, right, so we have to deal with this basis set. So frequently we actually optimize the basis set for solid. We have to have a decent weakly correlated method, which we do, which is this GW based on this very efficient grids. And we have the embedding scheme. So what can we do? So see, this is like a cubic perovskite strontium manganate. The strontium manganate is a frequent component of ceramics. I don't necessarily know if there is so much physically relevant about it from the point of view of chemistry, but what is interesting about it is that basically, you know, the common methods that physicists use, like GW plus EDMFT, fails to describe this compound in paramagnetic phase. So the paramagnetic phase is insulating. This is known from experiment. And basically, like DFT calculations and GW plus EDMFT says that this compound is metallic. So we'll try to figure out why, what's happening, and if we can do any better. But it's also known that methods like LDA plus DMFT, they can actually get this compound as insulating in paramagnetic phase, but only if they adjust parameters for it to become insulating. Okay, so if I start manipulate with U and J, I can make it insulating, but that's, you know, kind of descriptive, not predictive. So these are the results from GW plus EDMFT. You can see that GW gives this compound as metallic, that, you know, you have the levels crossing the Fermi level, like the bands crossing the Fermi level. And this is GW plus EDMFT result. You can see again that there are these bands crossing the Fermi level, that you have non-zero density of states near the Fermi level. So the compound is metallic. So what we want to know is the origin of this metallic peak, and, you know, if our embedding method can do any better. So what we do, we first, as I told you, have to run this basically huge GW method, usually on this compound. So we use this GTH DZVP basis. With GTH pseudo potential, we study paramagnetic phase. Our temperature is around 1000 Kelvin, and we have 6 by 6 by 6 crystal lattice. So you can see that when we run GW, so these are the experimental results, this dashed line. So this is photoelectron spectroscopy and taxas. So you can see that definitely experiment shows that it's insulating, right? You don't have any density near the Fermi level. When one runs the GW and one orbitally resolves the peak, so one checks which peaks are due to EG, T2G, and, you know, the oxygen P pi and P sigma, you can see that there is this density of states within the Fermi level. So GW definitely, you know, does predict that it's metallic. Okay, so this is like a failure of this weakly correlated method to predict the proper right phase. So it predicts metal, not MOT insulator. So we kind of, you know, try to figure out what happens. And if you have this scheme, right, you have to start with this metallic GW and keep iterating. So that's a terrible starting point, obviously, if we know that this compound is insulating. So we, you know, we decided that if the orbitals are so bad, we're going to basically drive it in that way that we solve one GW, we solve the impurity problems, and that hopefully will kind of, you know, update our answer enough. And then we have to solve the GW again with this updated density so that all the orbitals have the chance to relax. So, right, so our scheme is like basically we do one iteration of GW method. We even don't drive it to convergence because the orbitals are so bad. Then we solve one shot of these impurity problems, which bring in strong correlation, and we solve GW again. So in a good iterative method, it shouldn't, you know, the order of iterations, if the attractor point is deep enough, shouldn't matter. Or, you know, hopefully will not matter, and we can show that it actually doesn't eventually. And we should be able to converge. So this is, you know, in comparison to like regular quantum chemistry, people sometimes talk about these methods which are perturb and diagonalize, or diagonalize and perturb, right? So this is like perturb and then diagonalize, if you want to see it that way. But basically this perturbative point is far enough from the exact solution that you have to manipulate with the scheme. So what's happening if we actually start running this iteration? So this is like a zoom in onto the Fermi level. You can see that it takes many iterations to actually converge it. So we are, you know, around more than 100 iterations. And when we are in this iteration, like, you know, 23, you can see that the density of states is still metallic near the Fermi level, but then once we iterate, actually becomes insulating. So we have two impurities. So we choose T2G and EG manganese orbitals, and you can see that indeed, you know, it's slowly, but it's converging. All these things are, right, like total energy, correlation energy, chemical potential are converging within these iterations. And then we can, you know, check indeed if everything is proper. So we can start with one impurity on manganese T2G orbitals. We can do manganese T2G and EG orbitals. Finally, we can even include oxygen P. And you can see that indeed our spectrum starts to look like experimental spectrum. So this big peak is corresponding to basically oxygen P orbitals, and when this peak in the unoccupied part of spectrum is manganese T2G. So this is orbitally resolved, right? With respect to all contributions, we can collect it all. So it really looks like experiment. And you can see that indeed this assignment can be done. We get nice insulated paramagnetic phase for this compound. So we can check what happens with the occupation number in the unit cell. You can see that if we run in GW, you will see the occupation numbers, which are more, you know, similar to kind of what would you expect from single reference method, right, by almost 2 and 0. But once you run the self-energy embedding, you see things are very partially occupied and very strongly correlated. So basically, right, that shows that self-energy embedding can really, you know, treat the strongly correlated system and can correct upon this failure of GW actually very well. So we are very pleased actually to see it. All right, so when we tried, you know, another compound, which is neodymium nicklate. So this neodymium nicklate, you know, nicklates are the newest rage in this, or maybe not so new, but one of the rages in the superconducting compounds. So basically this is like a cuprate analog, where people believe that along this nickel oxide layer, they basically behave the same as cuprate, because you have like the D9 nickel layers, which are similar to the D9 nickel layers of the cuprate chemistry. And again, there are, you know, multiple people who have done this before. But one of the things that is never satisfactory, so this is, you know, not like we are not here first to run this or anything, but what is unsatisfactory in this compound is basically that either they have to manipulate with U and J to recover experiment, or one actually has like a sort of cloudy pictures with which orbitals should matter and which orbitals should be strongly correlated. So I will show you some kind of preliminary results for this, where we try to resolve which orbitals are strongly correlated and how it compares to, you know, to the calculations that other people have done. So one of the things is that, see, this is neodymium nicklate, so neodymium has F orbitals. So one of the questions is how the F orbitals of neodymium matter, and what about the P orbitals of oxygen? So most of the calculations that have been done previously were either, you know, completely discarding the neodymium F and treating them as a core orbitals, so freezing them out. They were not taking this oxygen piece. And, you know, if you're a chemist, then you would think that this oxygen piece probably matter because they actually should hybridize. And obviously, you know, we don't use any parameters. So I have like, if it doesn't work, I have nothing to manipulate. So I'm avoiding any parameters. So as I told you, most of the time, people don't take any neodymium F to these calculations. And most of the time, the only impurity that they take is from the nickel D, okay? So again, we optimized actually the basis sets for in material specific way for this neodymium and oxygen here to be sure that everything is fine. We run GW in this embedding scheme. And what do we see? So see, like these are calculations of Philip Werner. So we agree with them that the neodymium D should be taken to the impurity. You can see that this is what they get, that the neodymium D matters. We actually get very similar picture of the neodymium D orbitals. So that's good. Then what about F? So if you run the GW, you can see that basically F is around the Fermi level. It definitely should matter. It should be strongly correlated. But once we run the self-energy embedding with all this F correlated, you can see that it moves below the Fermi level. So it was actually a lucky guess that people don't take it. Probably doesn't matter. It's of course we cannot tell that if they didn't take it, if you know, it wouldn't matter, but it seems it doesn't matter that much. What about oxygen P? You can see that from DFT, the oxygen P is either way above or way below Fermi level. If you actually run the correlated calculations, you can see that it's near the Fermi level. So probably oxygen P should be taken. All right, so this is, you know, how you can recognize from these methods which orbitals matter, right? And how to carry out this calculation. But at the end, I'm going to tell you one more example of the strongly correlated calculation where we use self-energy embedding, which is for bismuth vanadate in a diamond anvil. So this is basically synthesis of the under pressure of oxide perovskite. So this bismuth vanadate is one of the last oxide perovskite that wasn't synthesized because it's impossible to synthesize it at ambient pressure. So it decomposes to bismuth and vanadium oxide. And it's predicted that this is a perovskite, which is antiferromagnetic, but metallic. And this is a very, you know, infrequent combination. Any of perovskites that are antiferromagnetic are usually insulating. And this is like any inorganic chemist would tell you that almost any perovskite, which is antiferromagnetic, is insulating. So they collected, so this was done by Dana Friedman, the synthesis under pressure, they collected, you know, the pressure as a function of bond length. And the problem is that in this diamond anvil, they have so little of this perovskite that they cannot open the diamond anvil and check, you know, if it's metallic or insulating. So really this is a good challenge for theorists because like literally, you know, there is nothing known, right? So it's, you cannot be descriptive, you have to be predictive here. So there are two phases, there is A and C phase. So depending how the spins are oriented. So you can see that in A phase, they basically all up in one plane, the other plane is down. And the C phase, these planes go diagonally, right? So see, this is what's happening here. So this is the DFT at the level of PBE. In the lowest pressure, so in the lowest pressure, if this is insulating, then it's insulating at the lowest pressure. So we study the lowest pressure. You can see that the DFT shows metallic character. We run the GW, shows still metallic character. We run the SEET, it still shows the metallic character, even though, you know, we put all the impurities on the D and oxygen and so on. So it's confirming that actually the DFT was right. If one runs this prediction this way, I want to say that this basically, these band structures, which we obtained here, they correlated band structure, they not, you know, just the eigenvalues of the Fock matrix, they really like, it's a not fully traced Green's function, which we are plotting. So it's like a spectral function plotted with respect to orbital index. So it includes all correlation. It's not one body picture. You can,
if you can, sorry, if you can wrap up because we need 5 minutes for anyway.
All right. So you can see that these are basically orbitals that, you know, are responsible for this metallic character. So it's bismuth P and vanadium D. But the interesting phase is the C phase. So you can see again, DFT gives very metallic character. And you can see that when one runs GW and SEET, this actually doesn't prove to be that correlated. GW is good enough. But you can see that there is a completely different orbital picture than from DFT. And instead of obtaining like a regular metal, you obtain a semi-metal, okay? So you would still have a metallic density of states, but basically, right, like you have this two, like it looks like an indirect band gap semiconductor, but with band gap equal to zero. Again, bismuth P and vanadium DXY is responsible for this. All right, so I hope that I told you that, you know, this, you can run this Green's function methods with embedding flavor for solids, and you can get fairly accurate, you know, results for compounds as complicated as this bismuth vanadate or basically strontium manganate. And I would like to thank people who have done the work. So a lot of this work was done by postdoc in my group, Sergei Iskakov, and graduate student Chanan Ye. Also with my other group members, Yambing and Runchi, who run a lot of calculations for this bismuth vanadate and neodymium nucleate. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Dominik. Any question, please? Raise your hand or in the chat. Oh, Gustavo.
Very nice, Dominika. On the perovskite, has anybody done a screen hybrid like HSC calculation? If I wouldn't trust PPE on the density.
We could have done it. I don't know. So you're asking for this bismuth vanadate, right? So for this bismuth vanadate, they only done LDA and LDA plus U, but we can run the screen hybrid and tell you what's happening.
If you have VASP, you can do that calculation, and that would, if it is a sort of zero semi-metal indirect gap guy, HSC will get it. I mean, or it will give you a much very 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 small gap. It will not predict metallic character if it is an indirect, you know, tiny gap semiconductor.
So Gustavo, one thing that you know that we have, right? Like if you look at the, if I go back. So see, this obviously we have some tiny broadening, right? So we try to change the broadening to see if, you know, maybe this is actually a tiny, right, a tiny gap, but we don't see that it changes with broadening. So we think that this is real metal, but I agree with you that we should run HSC.
But then you need to look at the density of states and then have you look at it. This is just band structure.
Read this paper here. So we can right now analytically continue. So this is full Green's function with all self-energy. And what we are printing are the components of density of states with respect to orbital index. So these are not just eigenvalues of the Fock matrix. So this is like really a kind of like, I really like it because this is a very good way of comparing what happens to DFT, but this is not just the eigenvalues of the Fock matrix.
Next, Rowan.
Thank you for your nice presentation. So I would like to make one point clear. So we embed the strongly correlated orbitals into the weakly correlated. You prefer that the zone for the strongly correlated overlap or not overlapped. I mean, for example, in the case of strontium, manganese, or O3 case, do you
so? So this were not overlapping because we basically could choose. So see, you have T2G and EG and this oxygen piece. So we don't need to have, the impurities are small enough that I didn't need to overlap them in order to create, you know, like a huge orbital space. So what do I mean by overlapping? Maybe this is actually like a little bit necessary clarification. So what I mean by overlapping, I mean that, you know, like if I, let's say, have six orbitals and I take first a group of four and then, you know, another group of four. So I would take 1, 2, 3, 4 and other group would be like, let's say 1, 2, 5, 6, right? So I would overlap or repeat 1, 2. I don't say anything how they overlapping in space because my oxygen piece and, you know, and the some of these T2Gs and EGs, they can be delocalized and they can overlap in space. Mm-hmm. So if for this cases, I didn't need to overlap because the orbital space is small enough.
Okay, thank you.
Just quick question. When we compare it with density functional theory, we have an exact theorem which tells us that if I know the electron density, I know everything about the system. Mm-hmm. Now, when I go to Green function, do we have an equivalent theorem which tells us if I mean, the basic variable here is the self-energy. Do we have like an equivalent theorem like what we have in density functional theory?
I'm not sure if you can say like equivalent theorem, but if you have the self, if some, like, if you look like how, you know, this Luttinger word functional is defined and how it's related to DFT. So then yes, you can tell that because see, there is this, there are these equations which are called Sham-Schluter equation, okay? Which allows to, if you have G and sigma, you can evaluate VXC, right?
I'm comparing the basic variable, density, basic self-energy. If I know the self-energy, do I know everything about the system as we do in density functional theory?
I think yes, I would say.
Okay, thank you. And now we'll move to the third talk by Gustavo Cesaria from